ظلمت سنة من أحيا الظلام إلى أن اشتكت قدماه الدر من ورم وشد من سغاب أحشاء وطوى تحت الحجارة كشحا مترف الآدم محمد.
هدايات ورحمات وبركات، بعض الناس يراها بعيونهم، بعض الناس يراها بقلوبهم.
Guidance, mercy and blessings on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bestows upon a person that some people perceive and some people don't. And some people who see them with their eyes, such that when they give gratitude for them, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala increases them. And in that regard, some people have more than others. Because one offers gratitude based upon well, that which manifests for them. As for those who see blessings bestowed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with their heart and not with their eyes, that they see that the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are consistently descending with each and every single breath that they take. Normal people can't see this, can't perceive this. And so therefore they're affected by the change that occurs in their environment. And so all of those things that soil or make render one's faith murky, that what they're affected by it. But when they see with the light of their heart the blessings that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bestows, they're not affected by all of those things that ordinarily exact an effect upon somebody in these sort of tangible realm. And this relates especially to women. Because sometimes they can become stressed out by certain things that ordinarily cause stress. But they shouldn't allow this to affect that which exists inside of their heart from the light of faith and connection to Allah Ta'ala. Yani the secrets that women carry inside of their souls. Yani they suffice to allow one to be successful in the face of any type of trial, tribulation or adversity. Yani what suffices us is that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ennobled us with by virtue of these realities. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to designate an entire day just to sit with the women folk and remind them of these realities. And those events which occurred in the life and times of the women who surrounded the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam or his daughters, affirms the words which I'm saying, as in the case of Sayyidatul Khadija, or Sayyidatul Fatima, alayhi wasalam, or Sayyidina Zainab, the daughter of the Prophet, alayhi wasalam.
Sayyidatina Rubayya, Sayyidatina Umm Kulthum, hasala alayhinna fi bidayat al-Islam, ma shay min al-hawadith, lakin lam yu'athir hada ala imanihim wa ala salatihim bil Rasul, sallallahu alayhi wasalam.
Or the two daughters of the Prophet, alayhi wasalam, Ruqayya and Umm Kulthum, are in the beginning of Islam that various events occurred in their life that did not exact an effect upon their what? Upon their faith. That the light of faith that exists in your hearts, and by praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and strengthening one's faith, anything that occurs in the life and times of that specific woman, that it won't affect their heart, it won't affect their faith. That it'll be incidental. As we see it as an example of Our Lady Zainab, رضي الله عنها.
Zainab bint al-Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, كانت عندها بنت.
That Zainab, the daughter of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that she had a daughter.
اسمها أمامة.
And her name was Umama.
كانت بنت صغيرة.
She was like a young girl.
فكانت مريضة.
And she got ill.
واحتضرت حتى كادت أن تموت.
And she reached the point of death until she was about to die.
كانت تريد الرسول يتدخل مباشرة.
And she wanted the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم to interfere with this.
ولو بطريق الدعاء والوحي.
يعني even through means of prayer and revelation.
الرسول في بعض المواضع ما يتحرك.
The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, sometimes you won't see him move.
يكون تحت القضاء والقدر الإلهي.
And he just remains still beneath divine destiny.
القضاء والقدر الذي لا يمكن دفعه يترك.
يعني destiny which cannot be repelled, the Prophet submits to it. And despite the great rank that he holds with Allah, the Prophet thereby steps back and leaves it because destiny has its own way of manifesting. So Sayyidina Zainab radiallahu ta'ala anha, when her daughter got ill, that she sent one of her relatives to the mosque.
فقالت له أخبر رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أن بنتي أمامة متعبة مدنفة مريضة وليأتي رسول الله.
He said, tell the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that my daughter is Umama is extremely weak and that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam should come unto her.
كان مشغولا بالدرس فقال ارجع إليها وقل لها فلتصبر ولتحتسب.
The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was busy. He was inside of a درس, and then he sent the messenger back and said, tell her to be patient and to anticipate reward from Allah.
كانت تريد من رسول أن يأتي مباشرة كما حصل في بعض الأحيان ودرع على بعض الناس فشفي مباشرة من المرض.
She wanted the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم to come immediately, as had previously occurred when the Prophet would come immediately and the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم would read over people such that they would immediately be healed.
ولكن الرسول لم يتدخل في هذه المرة.
But the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم this time he never got involved.
ابنته زينب.
And this is his daughter Zainab.
وأعز الناس إليها ابنتها.
يعني of the most and the most beloved person to her, yani was her daughter, precious thing to her was her daughter.
فأرسلت قريبها هذا مرة أخرى وتقول ارجع إلى رسول الله وقل له الآن يأتي.
So she said, go back. When the messenger returned and informed her of this, she said, go back to the messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم and tell him to come right now.
النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أيضا قال أمرها فلتصبر ولتحتسب.
And the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم once again commanded her just to be patient and to anticipate her reward with Allah.
Then المرة الثالثة قالت سيدتنا زينب اذهب إليه قل له يأتي الآن أو هي ستأتي بنفسها.
So she said, she sent the messenger back once again and said, tell the messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم to come, either come right now or we're going to come unto him.
الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم في المرة الثالثة قال.
So on the third occasion, the Prophet ﷺ stood up.
ودخل إلى البيت ورأى تلك الطفلة الصغيرة.
And then he entered the house and he saw the young girl.
وكانت تموت.
And she was يعني about to die.
لكن هذه المرة ما دعا الله.
But on this occasion, the Prophet ﷺ didn't pray to Allah, didn't supplicate. He allowed destiny to manifest.
وحتى هم رحمته بكى.
Even the Prophet ﷺ, due to his own mercy and compassion, he began to cry. And the women who were actually in the house alongside Sayyidina Zainab, like Ayman and Baraka, they saw the Prophet ﷺ crying. And they were amazed.
He
said, O Messenger of Allah, even you cry? The Prophet ﷺ said, I'm not crying. The way I cry is not the way you cry, even though we see tears flow from the Prophet ﷺ's eyes.
He said,
I'm not crying, but this is mercy that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has placed in my heart. That when the Prophet ﷺ's heart is filled with mercy, then his eyes swell up with tears.
كثير في حياتها لكنها صبرت والنبي مرها بالصبر.
And look at Zainab radiallahu ta'ala anha, the daughter of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. There were many things that occurred inside of her life, but the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to counsel her with patience.
فبعض النساء قد تتعرض كذلك ولكنها تصبر وتشكر وتحمل.
Likewise also, يعني many women are going to be confronted with difficulties, but they should what? They should be patient. They should be thankful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They should praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
تصبر بالقلب.
And they should be patient with their heart. And they should show gratitude with their tongue. Such that that which is evil in their life will be transformed into good. And that which they believe to be a tribulation will then be transformed into a gift. Initially, maybe it wasn't in something in their best interest. But due to the way she embraces it, it becomes something which is in her best interest. On the basis of what? Contentment of the heart and gratitude on the tongue. We ask Allah that he protects all of you. And he protects women in every place. From all adversity and evil. And may he make everything in their lives good for them. If any sisters have any questions, inshallah ta'ala, they can articulate them questions or they can send papers to the front, inshallah ta'ala. So the question is that if a woman is in a state of adversity or experiencing difficulties, but she's not patient, however, upon her tongue she's showing gratitude, then will this transform her state or transform the situation?
أي أمر يحصل الإنسان يظن أمر سيء ويشاهده فعلا أمر سيء ممكن يتحول إلى شيء حسن.
And anything that somebody experiences which is evil, whether experientially evil or whether in reality it is evil, that it can be transformed into something that is good.
ممكن يتحول إلى خير له. أي شيء.
Yeah, everything can be transformed into good.
وأي أمر يحصل الإنسان يراه إنه سيء في أوجه حسنة تخفى عليه.
And anything that one perceives to be evil, there is good within it, which you're oblivious to. As we said, how do you transform it, or how does that good manifest that lies within it? Through patience that is emanating from the heart, and through gratitude that manifests upon the tongue.
طيب إذا لم يوجد الصبر في الباطن والرضا يكفي في اللسان بالبداية الحمد لله الحمد لله.
So if one doesn't have patience inside of the heart, then gratitude upon the tongue, praising the Allah Subhanahu wa Taala, in the beginning will be sufficient.
ما كان تكرر الحمد لله وإن لله وإن إليه راجعون اللهم اجر في مصيبتي واخلف لي خيرا منها الحمد لله ترجع إلى الله هو يحول بعد ذلك.
Like saying the great statements, all praise is due to Allah Taala. يعني verily to Allah we belong and verily unto Him we return. Oh Allah, يعني reward me in this tribulation of mine and replace it with that which is better for me.
أي أمر يسيء الإنسان يعني يجعله يستأ في الباطن ويتأثر ويحزن في الباطن ممكن يتحول في للإنسان نعمة مرة أخرى.
Anything that one يعني perceives to be evil or one experiences as evil with the heart, as we mentioned, that this can be transformed into that which is good for that person.
تمام بالحمد والشكر والرضا.
And by virtue of praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, showing gratitude to Him and contentment of the heart. And thereby to await patiently until Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala manifests that good to
Him.
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not allow anything to happen in the lives of anybody save that there is good or benefit for that person.
هذا يخفى عند المقدرات مثلا لا يعرف الإنسان كيف هذا في صالح وين الصالح اللي في هذا متى يظهر هذا الصالح.
And the things that sort of يعني murky its waters such that a person can be oblivious to how is this thing good for me, where is the good that lies within it.
لكن يكون في صالح قطعا إن شاء الله.
But there is good in it, no doubt whatsoever.
الحاجة اللي ما فيها صالح حاجتان فقط أما كل شيء يبقى فيه صالح وإن كان يخفى.
That there are only two things that what no good lies within them whatsoever. Everything else other than that, there's good within it.
الخصلتان اللتان ليس فيهما صالح لأي إنسان الكفر الموت على الكفر في الدنيا ودخول النار في الآخرة هذا لا في أي صالح ولا أي شيء حسن لا من قريب ولا من بعيد لا ظاهر ولا باطن.
And those two things that which is no good whatsoever in them, the first of them is to die in a state of disbelief. When somebody dies in a state of disbelief, there's no good whatsoever in that act in and of itself. And then the second is eternal damnation and hellfire. So therefore, whenever anything that we experience to be evil or difficult in our lives, we should say Alhamdulillah, Alhamdulillah, praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And thereby it will be transformed to good. After 20 days. Or 40. Or even more. So the question is, how can we increase or even begin this contentment, stroke patience in the heart, and shukr upon the tongue? The Habib Kadhim, Hafizullah, says, first and foremost, begin with the tongue. Because all good that comes into the life of a person, it begins first and foremost with one doing those things willingly.
يعني في البداية الإنسان يقول الحمد لله الحمد لله هذا باختيار بقدرته لكن بركات الحمد بعدين تجي من الله شيء كبير.
And thereafter it's blessings which come from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So in the beginning anyone praises Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala themselves is something they do willingly. Alhamdulillah, alhamdulillah, alhamdulillah. And thereafter, due to continuation upon that good, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala infuses it with blessings. And that's a gift from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
التصبر في البداية عند الإنسان باختيار يقدر. ولكن بعدين المعية تجي من الله أكبر شيء عظيم ما يوازي حتى هذا الشيء اليسير الذي بذله الإنسان.
And the means, seeking the means for gratitude or what have you, is within the reach of everybody. But then thereafter, gifts which are beyond reach, may these only come from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they are procured through you engaging the means.
في البداية نقول الحمد لله إنا لله وإنا إليه راجعون وتكون بواطننا مستسلمة مفوضة الأمر لله بعدين يتحول.
So in the beginning we should embellish our tongue with praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and statements like إنا لله وإنا إليه راجعون to Allah we belong unto him we return. That's how we begin in the beginning upon the tongue.
يتحول عاجلا أم آجلا.
And then thereby it will be, the issue will be transformed immediately or later. And this is something we know through experience. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, verily Allah is with those who are patient. And verily Allah will give those who are patient their reward without limit. And if you show gratitude, I will increase you, Allah says. It's just for the person to realize the state in which he's in. If he feels that the state in which they're in is a state of blessing, then alhamdulillah, 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 praise Allah.
أنا أدرك الحال الذي هو فيه قال إنه مقصر فعلا أشعر بالتقصير طيب استغفر الله استغفر الله استغفر الله.
But if you feel that you're in a state of deficiency, then it's forgiveness. استغفر الله استغفر الله استغفر الله.
أنا أدرك الحال الذي هو مثل فيه خوف حسبي الله ونعم الوكيل حسبي الله.
If you feel you're in a state.
يعرف حاله أنت في آمن من حال الآن هل أنت في حال النعمة تريدين أن تحفظ أو في حال التقصير تريدين الزيادة أو في حال الأسوء تريدين الانتقال في أي حال مثلا.
Or if you're in a state of fear, Hasbunallah wa ni'man wakeel. Allah suffices me, what a beautiful God he is. All that's upon you is to realize what is your state, what's your situation. Is it that you're in a state of blessings? So praise Allah. Is it that you're in a state of deficiency? Seek forgiveness from Allah. Are you in a state of fear? Then seek Allah Ta'ala's protection.
كل شيء إذن له شرع الله سبحانه وتعالى في تعليمات النبي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم مخرج من بابه.
Yani, every, there's always a way out from the difficulties that one is in, and that is clarified in the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And that is found inside of the statement of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the statement of Allah ta'ala substantiates this, where Allah ta'ala says, whoever is conscious of him, and whoever has taqwa, Allah will give them a way out, and then Allah will sustain them or provide for them from where they perceive not. And that, the details of that is in accordance with people's states. And also in accordance with that which is occurring inside of their life. Every event that manifests in your life, there is an exit though, there's a way out. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, that there's never going to be a situation in which you're in except there's an exit
though.
As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, whoever has conscious fear of Allah ta'ala, Allah will give them a way out. And He will provide for them from where they perceive not. And here, provision here is tangible provision and also intangible provision. The question is, please can you tell us any supplications to help during times of despair and difficulties? And Habib Kadhim, Hafidhullah, said there are many prayers and supplications that one can make. But we're going to give you some which are brief, because some of them are extremely lengthy.
تأخذ من الإنسان أربع ساعات أي مشكلة مهما كانت كبيرة لو قرأ إنسان 41 مرة من سورة ياسين تروح.
So يعني
هني تحتاج أربع ساعات.
يعني one is it will take you like around 4 hours to do, so it's long 4 hours, and that is to anytime you're in a state of difficulty to recite سورة ياسين يعني 41 times.
ولكن أيسر من ذلك وأسهل من ذلك هذا الذكر العظيم حسبنا الله ونعم الوكيل حسبنا الله ونعم الوكيل.
But what's sort of easier than that is the great sort of invocation, which is حسبنا الله ونعم الوكيل حسبنا الله ونعم الوكيل. And Allah suffices us, and what a beautiful God He is.
أي شدة مثلا لو أصابت مسلمة شدة أو شيء من أي أمر مهم أو غير ذلك تقول هذا الدعاء.
And anytime one's in a state of difficulty, a Muslim woman's in a state of difficulty, she should make this prayer. 450 times.
بعد صلاة العشاء.
After praying Isha, Salat al-Isha.
مستقبلة القبلة.
Facing the Qibla.
تكون لوحدها في المكان ما أحد عندها من الناس.
She should be alone in whatever place she's in, alone.
تمام. يكون مع بخور أو رائحة طيبة في المكان.
And she should have also infused the place with a fragrance, i.e. with بخور.
توجه نحو الكعبة نحو القبلة حسبنا الله ونعم الوكيل حسبنا الله.
And she should be facing the Qibla and she should be saying حسبنا الله ونعم الوكيل حسبنا الله ونعم الوكيل.
طيب يفرج الله سبحانه وتعالى عن أي مسلم في أي مكان.
And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then, and this applies to any Muslim, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then will relieve them of their difficulties. In terms of our physical form, we turn towards the noble Kaaba. And our heart is with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wherever we may be, but the Kaaba is the direction we face. Why do you sit alone? Because people ordinarily, when they're alongside people, they're preoccupied with people. But when you're alone, then there's nothing that can distract you here. You're directing yourself towards Allah. This is after Isha.
أي هم مثلا عند الإنسان أو غم وما شابه ذلك موجود في أذكار النبي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم.
So any type of distress or depression that afflicts a person, you can find the cure for that inside the hadith of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم.
أذكار مختصرة وأذكار مطولة كلها علاجات من الرسول رحمة أمته صلى الله عليه وسلم.
Sometimes they're brief and sometimes they're lengthy, but all of them are manifestations of the mercy of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم towards his nation.
لماذا الرسول ذكرها لو ما كانت موجودة في الدين كيف الناس يعملون؟
يعني Why did the Prophet make mention of them? Because when they exist, if people didn't have knowledge of them, then what would they do? That they would think that the religion in and of itself is deficiency, such that it doesn't even have the cures for the problems that people face in their lives. But it exists in religion. And except that some people don't know that it exists, one, or sometimes if they do know that it exists, they don't apply it, they don't bring it into their lives properly.
هذا الدعاء دعاء سماه النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم دعاء الكرب كما ورد عن ابن عباس رضي الله عنهما. خصوصا إذا كان الإنسان كرب يعني صار مهموم جدا ومهموم جدا فيقول هذا الدعاء.
So there's a dua which is related by Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Abbas رضي الله تعالى عنه وردان authority of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, which is a dua when somebody is in a state of like deep depression or anxiety.
لا إله إلا الله العظيم الحليم.
So Habib, if you want to take the dua, you're La ilaha illallah.
Al-Azim al-Halim.
Al-Azim al-Halim. La ilaha illallah. Al-Azim al-Halim.
La ilaha illallah. Rabbul Arsh al-Azim.
La ilaha illallah. Rabbul Arsh al-Azim. La ilaha illallah.
Rabbul Samawati.
Rabbul Arsh al-Azim. La ilaha illallah. Rabbul Samawati.
Wa Rabbul Ardi wa Rabbul Arsh al-Kareem.
Wa Rabbul Ardi wa Rabbul Arsh al-Kareem.
هذا يكون متى عندما يقرب الإنسان يعني يغلب عليه الهم أو الغم بحيث ما في وقت عنده حتى للتروح.
And this again is when somebody is in like a constant state of depression, like to the point that they find no relief whatsoever inside of their lives. This is a dua they should preoccupy themselves with.
لكن سبحان الله أحيانا يصيب الإنسان وقت هم وقت طبيعي وقت غم وقت كذا فيقول هذا الدعاء.
But sometimes it's not يعني a constant inside of somebody. Sometimes they're depressed, but then they get better. They're depressed, they get better. So in that situation, you should say this prayer.
La ilaha illallah qabla kulli shay.
La ilaha illallah qabla kulli shay.
La ilaha illallah ba'da kulli shay.
La ilaha illallah ba'da kulli shay.
La ilaha illallah yabqa rabbuna wa yafna kulli shay.
La ilaha illallah yabqa rabbuna wa yafna كل شيء.
إذا شعر الإنسان إنه مغموم يقوله. إذا شعر إنه طبيعي يترك.
When a person is depressed, they should say it. And when they feel okay, they should not say it.
وأيضا هذه الثلاث السور.
And likewise, also there are three verses one should recite.
نعم حتى ممكن يعطونها أي أحد من أقاربهم أو أهلهم إذا كان عندهم أو ضيق.
And likewise, you give this to anyone of your family who experiences sort of depression.
سواء كان يعرف سببه أو لا يعرف سببه.
Regardless of whether they know the cause or not of that depression.
فيقرأ هذه السور سبع مرات سورة الانشراح.
So they should recite these surahs or verses in the Quran seven times. The first of them is سورة الانشراح. أي ألم نشرح لك صدرك سورة الانشراح.
وسورة الفيل ألم ترى كيف فعل ربك
بأصحاب الفيل. Second is سورة الفيل ألم ترى كيف فعل ربك بأصحاب الفيل.
وسورة قريش لإلاف قريش.
And the third is سورة قريش لإلاف قريش. The question is, how can you encourage your friends or sisters to practice Islam more without being too pushy?
أول أساس من هذا ظهور النية الصالحة. كيف نعرف أن الله عز وجل يريد أمر يرسله إلى قلوب العباد؟
The first and foremost is that it's through good intentions. How do you know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants something? It's through that thing being existent in the heart of the person, i.e. that Allah Ta'ala sends this to the heart of somebody. You think about it. So in this case, يعني, how do we know that Allah Ta'ala wants friends or sisters of this particular questioner to actually be close and be practicing Islam? It's because Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala placed the concern inside of your heart. So therefore, show gratitude.
طيب النية دي علينا نحافظ عليها وننميها. ونقبلها لأنها نية حسنة وعظيمة من الله.
So therefore, يعني that intention inside of your heart, one needs to stand guard over it, and one needs to nurture it.
حتى نراها واضعا ملموسا في الهداية وفي الصلاح الناس وفي.
Until you actually see the intention, يعني become يعني embodied, it becomes physical. I see people guided, you see people praying, you see people you're concerned about practicing religion.
وهذا شيء يسير.
And this, in reality, is easy.
الأمر الأول الدعاء لهم لأقاربنا هؤلاء وحتى للناس كلها ندعو الله دائما لهم إن الله يشرح صدورهم ويهديهم ويوفقهم ويدينهم.
And the first of them is to pray for them. Those people you're concerned about, they should constantly be inside of your prayer, asking Allah Ta'ala to render them successful, Allah Ta'ala to guide them, Allah Ta'ala to take them by the hand.
الأمر الثاني تكون معاملتنا حسنة لهم وأخلاقنا جيدة معهم لأن هذه دعوة يسمونها بلسان الحال وليست بالمقال.
And the second is what is that you should display good character towards them. And this type of da'wah, this type of a way that you're calling them to the religion is more so about the state as opposed to it being verbal.
الخصلة الثالثة المباشرة معهم بالألفاظ. إذا وجدنا فرصة أو مناسبة ندعوهم مجالس خير مجالس ذكر ندعوهم للمجيء نحثهم في الذهاب إليها.
And then the third is with the tongue. You should now speak to them. And you should try to encourage them. If there's a daras you're going to or a class or whatever it may be, that you want, that you invite them to, ask them to come alongside with you. And once you've prayed for them, okay, now you can call them.
إذا لم ندعو لهم في الباطن قد لا يستجيبون في الظاهر لو قلنا لهم احضروا المجلس وحضروا درس وحضروا مولد وحضروا كذا.
And when you haven't prayed assiduously for them, then often you may find that they won't respond to you when you ask them to come alongside you to a
درس. ندعو لهم في الباطن ونكلمهم في الظاهر ونتعامل معهم معاملة حسنة فتكون الهداية.
So therefore, three things: you pray for them and with your heart assiduously. Secondly, you all display good character towards them, and the third is that you speak unto them, you speak to them, invite them unto that which is good. Every Muslim should be concerned about the guidance of their family members. Every Muslim should be concerned about this. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves this and He wants this. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam loves this and wants this. However, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He didn't send angels to guide humanity. It's us who have to guide humanity. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi likewise, He looks at his nation, like what are they doing? How are they trying to guide others? Prophet is in a state of prayer always. And so therefore we should do this, and it's easy for all of us to do. To pray, supplicate. And good conduct with people. And thereby to speak to them verbally. بعد كل شيء لا إله إلا يبقى ربنا ويفنى كل شيء ويفنى كل شيء.
هذه الثلاث الآيات.
So the question here relates to for infertility, a dua for infertility, and Habib Kadhim, he says three verses.
مجربات.
That again, these are proven true due to experience. And here, it's not just that a woman will be able to sort of have children, but she'll have pious children, as is mentioned inside of the Quran.
فيبغي لكل مسلمة أن ترددها أيضا ليكون أولادها وبناتها وحتى من بعدهم طيبين صالحين.
So on that basis, that all Muslim women should implement this prayer, and in order to have righteous progeny.
حتى التي لا تنجب لو كررتها ممكن أن تنجب.
And even a woman who is يعني infertile, then that situation could be changed.
الأولى قوله تعالى. ربي هب لي من لدنك ذرية طيبة إنك سميع الدعاء هكذا قال سيدنا زكريا.
So the statement of سيدنا زكريا inside the Quran, ربي
هب لي
من لدنك
ذرية
ربي هب لي من لدنك ذرية طيبة ذرية طيبة
إنك سميع الدعاء
إنك سميع الدعاء Oh my Lord, يعني grant me beautiful in progeny verily you are the one who hears prayers
تمام الثانية
The second
ربي لا تذرني فردا وأنت خير الوارثين
ربي لا تذرني فردا ربي لا تذرني فردا
وأنت خير الوارثين
وأنت خير الوارثين وأنت خير الوارثين Oh my Lord, do not leave me alone. You are the best of those who inherit or allow others to inherit.
ربنا هب لنا
Third, ربنا هب لنا
من أزواجنا
ربنا هب لنا من أزواجنا
وذرياتنا قرة أعين
من أزواجنا وذرياتنا قرة أعين
واجعلنا للمتقين إماما
واجعلنا
للمتقين
إماما
إذا رددت المرأة هذه الدعوات حتى أن كانت غير متزوجة ستتزوج وستكون هذه الذرية طيبة كيف ستكون هذه الذرية طيبة سيسر لها الله عز وجل
So here, that again, there's multiple benefits. Habib Kadhim made mention of some, a woman who's infertile, then she will become fertile. For women to have righteous children, and likewise it's also used for a woman who is single and desires to get married.
She should
repeat it often after prayer, yani at the end of the night, when she wakes up in the midst of the night. Whenever Muslims come together and are praying, that she should also seek the opportunity to likewise pray using this.
ما يريد الدعوات الباقي يقبل هؤلاء يقول هؤلاء خلاص إذا قبل دعوة يقبل بعد دعوات.
What's good about gatherings is that when people are praying, Allah Subhanahu wa Taala doesn't accept one over the other; He just accepts everybody. Forgive and also protect oneself from family members who come between husband and wife and cause doubt and disharmony. Now one protects themselves by implementing prophetic invocations and supplications.
تفعله إذا خاف الإنسان الخوف على نفسه من أذى أو من سحر أو من أي شيء يقول حسبنا الله ونعم الوكيل يحفظه الله.
And even the dua we're going to give you, حسبنا الله ونعم الوكيل, that one should use that as a means of protecting themselves when in a state of fear or the like.
تمام. فيتكرر فيحفظه الله عز وجل.
So therefore you should repeat it often, and إن شاء الله تعالى الله تعالى will protect you.
طيب في المسامحة للأقارب يعرف الإنسان إنه عندما يؤذي ذلك الإنسان الذي أذاه ما يستفيد شيء.
يعني And one, in terms of when somebody is trying to go and attempting to harm one, the first thing you should know is that yani, if you're going to repel evil with evil, there's no benefit in that whatsoever. So you should know that first and foremost. And likewise, also it bars you from like a great reward, as we heard in the verse, Allah Ta'ala said, verily, He gives those who show patience. A reward without any limit.
طيب أيضا لما ندعو على الإنسان الذي مثلا يدين أو ما شابه ذلك ربنا ما يحب هذا. ربنا عز وجل ما يحب منا هذا. مع أنه لو دعا الإنسان ربي قد ينتقم من الظالم. لكن يحب منا المسامح. لا إحنا نفعل ما يحبه.
And likewise, when we pray against somebody, or you pray against somebody who's harmed you or seeks to harm you, so you pray against them for Allah Ta'ala to harm them. Allah Subhanahu wa Taala doesn't like this whatsoever. Doesn't like when somebody does that. Although Allah may hear the prayer, listen to the prayer, and then exact revenge on that person, but He doesn't like the fact that you actually asked Him to do that, Subhanahu wa Ta'ala. Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala, He wants good for His slaves.
هم الناس يغيرون على نفسهم.
Yani it's people who sort of وميكي themselves.
فنحن لما يعني نسامح الناس الله يحب هذا ونتماشى مع الأمر الذي يريده الله.
But when we forgive people, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves that, and then we try to align ourselves with the affair that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants. We to say that somebody was harmed by somebody else and that that person did not forgive the person. Allah ta'ala can punish that person. Why? Because they extended harm unto another person.
يريد أن لا يعاقب الإنسان، فما تكون العقوبة إلا لأجل العدالة.
يعني but Allah Ta'ala doesn't want to punish, and Allah Ta'ala only punishes because He's just.
لذلك نحن لما نسامح يحب الله هذا.
But then when we ask Allah Ta'ala to forgive, or we forgive that person, now this was something Allah Ta'ala loves.
والنبي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم لذلك يسامح الناس دائما.
And the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, so thereby we see that he صلى الله عليه وسلم will always forgive people and pardon people.
كما لو فرضنا أن أب عنده أولاد.
It's the example like a father who has several children.
فأحد الأولاد مثلا ضرب أخاه.
So one child hit another.
فالأب قال أنا إذا سأعذبك.
So the father then says, okay, I'm gonna.
لكن هو يحب أولاده.
I'm gonna discipline you, but the father loves his children.
فيتمنى أن الأخ الأكبر يسامح الأصغر حتى لا يتعرض هو للعقوبة.
And what he would really want is for the other's brother. The one who was hurt to forgive the one who hurt him, so that he doesn't have to want discipline the other.
يعني
all of the creation of Allah Ta'ala are the dependents of Allah Ta'ala, they're his slaves.
الصالح والسيء والشرير والخير.
يعني the one who is righteous, the one who is not so righteous, the one who is good, the one who is evil.
ولكن الأنبياء والصالحين دائما يأخذون الناس إلى الخير.
يعني but the prophets and the righteous, they're always endeavoring to take people to that which is good.
وأي أمر يساعد على هذا يعملون حتى وإن كان سامحوا في حق أنفسهم.
يعني anything that assists them in that, that's what they bring into their life, even when it relates to themselves, like they're the ones who've been harmed.
وطبعا لما نسامح يكون لنا أجر عظيم من الله كبير جدا.
And obviously when we forgive, there's a great reward behind that.
كما قال تعالى فمنعها وأصلحها فأجره على الله شيء هاي.
As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, that the one who pardons and rectifies, then their reward is upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, yani bewildering reward. My mum is not a Muslim, she is staying with us for a while. Is there any dua I can make, and will the Shaykh pray for her? So the beginning of guidance for this mother is the fact that the daughter is now thinking about her guidance. So again, when you think about or you're concerned for your family members, as we mentioned, that this is a letter from Allah, a message from Allah. So there are three things that you can do. Then the first is that you should always ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to open up your heart to Islam and to guide her. Second, obviously, is to treat her well.
إذا أرادت أن تكلمها عن الإسلام أو عن الدين تقرأ هذه الآيات القرآنية من سبب الهداية.
And the third is that if you want to sort of speak to her about religion so that she'll be guided, then first and foremost you should recite these three verses.
أولا تقرأ سورة الانشراح كاملة ألم نشرح لك صدرك.
The first of them is you should recite سورة الانشراح ألم نشرح لك صدرك. Recite that in its entirety.
ثانيا تقرأ قوله تعالى فمن يريد الله أن يهديه يشرح صدره للإسلام.
And the second is to recite that verse, whoever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to guide, He opens up their heart to Islam, that verse.
وثالثا تقرأ قوله تعالى والذين اهتدوا زادهم هدى وآتاهم تقواهم.
And then the second is that those who were guided, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guided them and then gave them the due portion of taqwa.
ثم يعني إذا وجدت الفرصة مناسبة تدعوها إلى الإسلام.
And then if you have what, if you find an opportune moment, you should call her, you should invite her into Islam. Very often we Muslims that we fall short. Sometimes somebody can be thinking years about Islam, but they never become Muslim unless we extend a hand. So this is about extending hands unto others.
أقرب إلى المسجد، لكن الذي تدعوه قد ينشطه ويتفاعل ويتحمس ويأتي بنفسه. مثل هذا المجلس قلنا قد إذا أقيم مثل هذا المجلس شخص أنت تدعوه الذي تدعوه يعني 100% أنه يأتي، لكن الشخص الذي لا تدعوه أنت قد يتفاعل هو يتحمس ويأتي بدافع من نفسه ورغبة من نفسه وقد لا يأتي. كذلك الناس عندما يدخلون الإسلام عندما ندعوهم نحن نسبة النجاح كبيرة. عندما نتركهم هم يفكرون ويدرسون ويقرؤون قد يطول هذا.
Habib said it's just like this, they say I'm gathering here. If there's somebody you invite to this gathering, the chances are they're going to come based upon your invitation, especially somebody who's close to you, proximate to you. But as for somebody you don't invite to this gathering, then it's possible but far-fetched that they're just going to turn up at the gathering without any other reason for coming to the gathering of itself. He said, likewise, in relation to da'wah or summoning people unto Islam, is that if you extend a hand to people, you invite people to Islam, yeah, there's a high chance that people can respond in the positive in that regard. But then when you don't invite people to Islam, then again, it's possible, but it can be far-fetched sometimes. And again, may Allah Ta'ala make the affair easy, but in reality it is easy.
لماذا لا تسلم من كذا وكذا؟ هل عندك موانع عن الإسلام؟ هل في تخوفات من الدين؟ إيش الصعب الذي ترى في الدين؟ ابعد الحواجز.
Why don't you become Muslim? You should be a Muslim. Like, what's the problem with Islam? What? You know, why don't you think Islam suits you?
كل شيء يعني ممكن في الإسلام يحل. يعني ليس الإسلام دين متزمتا ولا متشددا.
And Islam. Yani can change, yani can suit the person who desires to come into Islam. Islam is not a fixed reality.
في مراعاة الأخف وفي درء المفاسد وفي تقديم الأصلح على المهم على الأهم.
And Islam can become easier for those who are weak. It can become stronger for those who are firm, etc. يعني it can suit person, place, and circumstance.
طيب لما ينتقل الإنسان أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وأشهد أن محمدا رسول الله. جدران وجبال من الأوهام تتحطم بكلمة لا إله إلا الله.
As soon as somebody declares the shahada, يعني just walls or veils of darkness or ignorance, يعني come crashing down, so that they begin to see things a lot clearer.
قبلها يرى شيء كبير وصعب الإسلام وجدا.
Before that, then they see everything is difficult, that Islam is difficult, so I can never be a Muslim.
And
likewise, the devil also sows ills inside of their mind, and how could you be a Muslim? How are you going to deal with this? How are you going to deal with that? But when they declare the shahada, then they get divine concern, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala assists them, and likewise also then they get prophetic concern in that they say Muhammad is the messenger of Allah, so the Prophet also prays for them, and it's at that point faith begins to become firm inside of their heart. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we ask that Allah ta'ala guides her, and inshallah that she become Muslim. And likewise all of one's relatives. And likewise anybody who has a family who's non-Muslim, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide them. So the question here is, how do you help someone in a difficult marriage which is affecting their health? He said, likewise, this is also in straightforward.
الخصال, إذا تمكنوا في البيت يقرؤون القرآن وتقرأ هي القرآن في البيت ستلاحظ بعد قراءة القرآن أن المشاكل إن لم تنعدم ستخف لن تستفحل ولن تكثر.
The first is that a person, you should advise that person to actually begin to recite the Quran regularly and often inside of the house aloud. And if the problems don't completely go away, you'll find that the problems are going to be lightened considerably.
هذا مجرب. كثير من المشاكل الكبيرة في البيوت عندما يقرأ القرآن خصوصا من الجانبين من الزوج ومن الزوجة. لكن إذا لم يقدر مثلا الزوج يقرأ القرآن هي تقرأ القرآن تروح المشاكل.
Once again, this is known through guidance and experience. And this is especially effective when the Quran is read from both sides, i.e. the husband and the wife are both reading the Quran inside of the house. But if that's not possible, then at least one of them.
طيب الخصلة الثانية هذا الذكر الذي أعطيناها يا حسب الله ونعم الوكيل تفعله بعد صلاة العشاء بنفس الطريقة إن شاء الله أي مشكلة كثير إن هذا الذكر مع الصدق يحلها ويؤول.
And the second is the dhikr that we gave you, بحسب الله ونعم الوكيل after عشاء. Likewise also with any problems, One should implement this, bring this into their life.
كذلك أيضا المرأة هي عليها في بعض الأحيان أنها تراعي زوجها وتقوم بعض التنازلات تراعي ما شابه ذلك.
And likewise, a woman should try in certain situations should try to sort of take like a step back, two steps back, and sort of try to show over concern for her husband.
كثير من الخلافات الزوجية والمشاكل. يعني لما يتدخلون الناس فيها تروح مباشرة عندما تترك للجانبين بل تستفحل ولا يقدرون على حلها مع أنها شيئا يسير سبحان الله.
And sometimes any simple matters if they're left alone they become very difficult to solve. But if they sort of if one engages them from the get go then they're simple and such that they removed immediately.
هذا علاج قرآني لا يمكن أن يكون لا ينفع أبدا.
This again is a Quranic cure. And so that means that it's always going to cure. As Allah Ta'ala says, he who's saying, if the problems are serious, then they should what? Then both sides should try and get somebody else, somebody outside involved, maybe another relative, somebody they trust involved. And if the intentions of both people are sincere, then therefore the problems will also be removed. Why this is a Quranic cure, as Allah Ta'ala says, send forth somebody who can adjudicate from his side and from her side, and that if they, these two people, desire to rectify between husband and wife, Allah will bring them together.
أو مؤخرا لها عن العبادة والطاعة والخير هذه عادية ممكن تقول.
So again, and the woman should not allow this situation to prevent her from good and from worship whatsoever. That this is a situation that can be solved.
إن الله مع الذين اتقوا والذين هم محسنون.
Allah is alongside, as he says in the Quran, Allah is alongside those who are conscious of Him, the people of taqwa, and those of ihsan. Those of excellence, طيب. And through the remembrance of Allah Ta'ala.
بالذكر هذا والأذكار تأتي معية الله معنا سبحانه وتعالى.
And through remembering this, and likewise through remembering Allah Ta'ala, the assistance of Allah Ta'ala descends.
والمولى هو سبحانه وتعالى بده يحب عباده، بيريدهم هم يعملون شيء لا يجد تأتيهم العناية.
And Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala loves His slaves, and He wants for them to do something in order for Him to now show divine concern and assistance for them. Assalamu alaikum, my husband will be taking another wife soon. I want to stay strong to bear this. Is there a dhikr I can do to help me? It's possible that she can be like extremely strong in this.
قد يؤدي إلى 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 فساد البيوت يعني قد بيوت تطلق على مثل هذا الأمر اللي يصير.
This affair, simple affair, can separate any husband and wife.
وهي ممكن المرأة المسلمة أنها تتقوى حتى لا تزوج زوجها زوجها ثلاث ما هي إلا واحدة لو وهي عادية قوية الإيمان واليقين والطمأنينة.
يعني it's also possible for actual even woman to strengthen herself so to become so strong so that she's able to bear three co-wives, not just one.
نعم الأمر الأول فقط أنها هي لا تتأثر باطنيا بهذا تحافظ قلبيا على هذا.
And the first and most importantly is she stands guard over her faith. She protects her heart from being affected by this as it relates to faith.
طيب وهذا له علاجات كثيرة جدا في الشرع مختولة ومختصرة.
And again, this has يعني many cures for this that exist inside of the sacred law. Some which are brief and some which are lengthy.
المختصر مثلا أن تقرأ في سيرة أمهات المؤمنين لازم تتذكر أن أمهات المؤمنين أعلى النساء عند الله من زوجات النبي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم. كانت كل واحدة منهن يعني عندها عدد من الزوجات مع الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم.
The first and foremost is to read the lives and the times of the actual wives of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم themselves. Remember, they were co-wives and they lived alongside يعني many of the wives of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. So one should draw inspiration and strength from those women.
والخصلة الثانية تفعل هذا الدعاء حسبنا الله ونعم الوكيل حسبنا الله ونعم الوكيل حسبنا الله ونعم الوكيل.
And the second is again is the dua we made mention of حسبنا الله ونعم الوكيل 450 times. Again, use that.
تمام ربنا سبحانه وتعالى سيعطيها قوة وطمأنينة وإنشراح وعدم أي قلق أو أي.
And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will then give her contentment of the heart and stillness and tranquility such that she's not going to be affected by this. And likewise, she should try to conduct herself with her husband based upon taqwa, God consciousness, and excellence, spiritual excellence, ihsan. Anytime she starts to feel weak, and she goes back to Hasbunallah wa ni'mal wakeel, Hasbunallah wa ni'mal wakeel, Hasbunallah wa ni'mal wakeel. It becomes a constant dhikr invocation for her. What is the best supplication to pray for protection from others, for jealousy and envy?
الحفظ من الغضب والغلب هذا الدعاء وارد عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم علمه الرسول سيدتنا عائشة سبع مرات في الصباح اللهم اذهب غيظ قلبي واجرني من مضلات الفتن سيذهب الغل والغضب من الإنسان
الحسد يعني حبيب says يعني for jealousy he says that and it's also for anger someone who's quick tempered or gets angered and rage quickly. That is a hadith that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam he taught Aisha to say this dua seven times. Allahumma adhib ghayba qalbi wa ajirni min mudallat al fitan. Allahumma adhib ghayba qalbi wa ajirni min mudallat من مدلات الفتن.
طيب الحسد.
Seven times. That's it.
في الصباح.
In the morning. Seven times in the morning after Fajr.
الحسد في ورد اسمه ورد الإمام أبو بكر السكران إذا خاف الإنسان على نفسه حسدا أو عينا لو قراه في الصباح وفي المساء يكون محفوظ إن شاء الله.
ليس خوف. And then the second, in terms of envy, there's a litany which is called the litany of Abu Bakr al-Sakran. Abu Bakr al-Sakran, at the Sabah al-Masa.
نعم إذا كان متخوفة أو متوقعة شيء فتقرأه في الصباح مرة وفي المساء مرة وعند النوم مرة.
That somebody, this litany is called the litany of Sakran. Sisters have it. It's in Habib Umar's Khalasat al-Madad. That then you should give it to the sisters who want it. That you recite that three times in the day. Once in the morning, okay, once in the evening, and once just prior to going to sleep, three times in the day. If one fears that somebody is envious of them, or somebody is going to give them the evil eye or the like, what have you, to use this as a protection. مشاعر سيئة قبل المشاعر السيئة.
المشاعر السيئة كلما خطر الإنسان خاطر يقول أستغفر الله أستغفر الله أستغفر الله.
So here the question is any du'as for successful marriage or to get rid of ill feelings. So Habib Kadhim Hafidhullah said anytime you have ill feelings then you should seek forgiveness from Allah Ta'ala. You say أستغفر الله أستغفر الله أستغفر الله.
طيب هذه أدعية مجربة للزواج.
And in terms of a marriage, he said the following du'a again is proven to be true.
هذه الآية تكررها.
This verse.
تكرر الأيسر عليها.
يعني the two verses, you should maybe do one, the one that you find easiest.
في سورة القصص قوله تعالى ربي إني ما أنزلت إلي من خير فقير.
The first one is in سورة القصص ربي. سورة القصص ربي إني لما أنزلت ربي إني لما أنزلت إلي من خير إلي من خير فقير. ربي إني لما أنزلت إلي من خير فقير.
تكرير هذه الآية القرآنية أيضا.
And then likewise another verse.
قوله تعالى وأذن في الناس بالحج.
When Allah Ta'ala says وأذن
في الناس
في الناس بالحج.
يأتوك رجالا.
يأتوك رجالا.
وعلى كل ضامر يأتين من كل فج عميق ليشهدوا منافع لهم. نعم هذه جزء من الآية وجزء من الآية الأخرى.
So you choose whichever one is easiest for you. إن شاء الله تعالى إن شاء الله المسلمين حتى تدعو لهم إن شاء الله
يتولاهم ويحفظهم ويفكهم الإيمان والدين واليقين والطاعة ويبعد عنهم الأشرار الباطنة والظاهرة والشرور الباطنة والظاهرة ويزيدهم من الإيمان واليقين والعمل الصالح في أهاليهم وقرباتهم ويبلغهم الأمان ظاهرا وباطنا في عافية وسلامة في سرور ونور وأنس وحبور وصفاء وخيرات وبركات وارتباط بالحبيب المصطفى توفيق الأعمال الصالحة يبقى سناها على مر الدهور مختلف العصور تجري على قبورنا بعد الموت لحظة الأولاد والبنات والذريات رسخ الإيمان في قلوبنا وقلوبهم واجعلهم أسباب للهداية وأسباب للرحمة وأسباب للنفع ظاهرا وباطنا بسر الفاتحة وإلى حضرة النبي
اللهم صل وسلم وبارك عليه وعلى آله الفاتحة